Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Chanel Hampton. I am with the Alumni Engagement and Giving Programs team here at Illinois Tech. I am going to present our speaker today. Just a couple of little logistical things before we get started. Everyone's phones and computers will be muted. If you don't mute it, I can mute it from my end. If you have any questions, we ask that we hold those until the end. There is a chat box if you would like to submit those before the end of the presentation. The presenter will get to those at that time. Okay. All right. So our speaker, Dr. Manu Vora, is Chairman and President of Business Excellence Incorporated, a global quality management consulting firm. He has over 42 years of leadership experience and has guided Fortune 500 companies with Baldrige Performing Excellence Assessment. For over 24 years as an adjunct professor, he teaches operations management courses at business schools globally. He is connected to over 80 educational institutions worldwide. He has published 65 articles. In 2013, he gave 2 TED Talks. And more recently, in 2016, he was appointed as a Fulbright specialist by the U.S. Department of State's Bureau of Education and Cultural Affairs. In 2012, he was awarded the Illinois Tech Alumni Medal. He received his master's and Ph.D. in chemical engineering from right here at Illinois Tech, and he will tell you a little bit more about himself in just a moment. All right. Manu, you can take over from here.
Okay. So thank you so much, Chanel, for your kind introduction and managing all the logistics for today's webinar, first in a series for 2017-18 IIT Alumni Career and Professional Development Series. I'm very delighted to join with all of you. And my special thanks to the chair of the committee, Brian, and my good friend, Dr. Raj Rajaram, for connecting me with Chanel and Brian. Now, let's begin just at an outset. World over, leadership is in great demand. Sadly, it is in short supply. So today's topic is going to focus on leadership excellence, not just at the top level, but at all levels, including all of us. So the roadmap for this afternoon is we will quickly review leadership development characteristics, then learn some of the key points from the various leadership models. Then I'll share with you the roadmap for leadership excellence and several best practice examples from the industry will be highlighted. And I'll also share some best references. Now, let's begin with a leadership quote from Lao Tzu. A leader is best when people barely know he exists, not so good when people obey and acclaim him, worst when they despise him. But of a good leader who talks little, when his work is done, his aim fulfilled, they will say, we did this ourselves. So in other words, the leader is the one who is going to be in the background supporting the troops, making sure that they are on the right path, on the right vision he has put together or he or she has put together. The other good definition I've seen is, in order to become a good leader, one is to listen first to all the stakeholders, learn from them, and then after learning what are the stakeholder requirements, then you begin to lead. You don't just come out on the scene saying, I'm a leader, follow me. It does not work. And I want to frame this particular leadership versus management in the context of change management. as we know, the world is going through so much turmoil. And in order to sustain the change for a long time, the leadership is one of the most critical issues. Leaders produce change, establishing direction, doing overall planning, aligning people, motivating and inspiring. Managing the change. We do need some management between 10 to 15%, and the role of the management is to bring predictability and establish order. And they do usual functions, plan, budget, organize staff, control, and problem solve. Now at the bottom, I have a simple line from Dr. Stephen Covey, a management think tank, and he's talking about difference between efficiency and effectiveness. Management is efficiency in climbing the ladder of success. Leadership determines whether the ladder is leaning against the right wall. In other words, look for effectiveness first and then efficiency. Now we are going to examine each letter of the word leadership, and on next slide, development. And I'll highlight some of the key areas the leaders must possess. We already talked about listening ability. Leaders are the great listeners. Second, E, the ethical. Now we all know the scandals around the world, around the year 2000, where Enron, Global Crossing, and number of other organizations went up in flame, and they took Arthur Andersen with them. When the top people in the organization are not ethical, the organization suffers. So the ethics has to permeate in entire organization, starting from the top. A leader must be authentic. You cannot fake the leadership. They need to be disciplined. They need to be looking for excellence. And I have a simple line. You chase excellence and success will run after you. They are role model. And let me talk a little bit about servant leadership. Servant leadership is where the leader is in the background, ensuring that the right things are happening effectively and efficiently by providing whatever resources needed and recognizing people for doing great things. Another important trait is honesty. And next one is integrity and the passion. So from this particular slide, I would focus on ethics, honesty, integrity, and passion. If you have the passion and perseverance, you can develop the grit, which is essentially needed to find long-term solution and managing the goals. Now for the development, the great leaders are delegators because they cannot do everything themselves. They create a people, they develop the people to take on bigger and better things. They are empathetic, they are visionary. Vision is very important for the leader. They are the one who are going to set the dream for the organization. They are also expert at what they do. They are learner. They keep learning, and they themselves learn continuously and create learning organization where everybody, including the organization, is learning. Now, in terms of optimism, as we know, a pessimist will say glass is half full. Optimist will say glass is, so pessimist will say glass is half empty. Optimist will say glass is half full. There is a super optimist person, Prime Minister of India, Mr. Modi. He says glass is completely full, other half is filled with air. So that's the level of optimism the leaders must display. They are always very positive. They are the motivators, motivate everyone to do the best for the organization. E, they are educator. Now, educators make a great leader. So I want to share one simple example. There was a casino in Las Vegas was losing money big time. So they invited a assistant professor from Harvard Business School to come and do some experiments of what audience they should invite so that they make money. So after doing some experiments, he figured out the right formula to invite people who are retired, have a lot of money at their disposal, and give them incentives to come and play at the casino. The casino adopted that practice. They started making money, and the professor was given the position of CEO, and he's still there. Now, why educators, they experiment all the time, and they have to deal with so many different constituencies, students, the parents, the regulators, administration, everybody, and they navigate through that and find the best solution. Leaders are great networkers, and leaders are also great teachers. So one example from GE, their headquarters for the training in Crotonville, upstate New York, the CEO, they themselves spend 50% of their time teaching the upcoming leaders, the pipeline of about 250 to 300 leaders from various units throughout the GE empire. And their sole objective is to impart the vision, mission, values, and upcoming things to take the GE at the next height. So leaders are great teachers. Now, granted, we cannot have all of these characteristics in a single person, but by exposing to these ideas, we can decide what is important for our organization and try to master these characteristics. Now, I want to show you some great global leaders, and there are two roles here. I'll start from the top left. Swami Vivekananda, he is the monk who came to Chicago to speak at the Parliament of the World's Religion, the first one, on September 11, 1893. He delivered a message saying that the East and West, the religious philosophy, there is more commonality than differences. Nelson Mandela, as we all know, in Africa, he was in jail for 27 years, coming out without any bitterness. He established the peaceful transition and democracy in South Africa. Of course, Abraham Lincoln, our favorite son from Illinois, he gave his life to keep the Union intact. Mahatma Gandhi, one of the most revered leader in India, the father of the nation, he gave his life. And he was such a simple person, did not have much worldly possession when he left. And on the bottom row, FDR essentially steered the nation during the Depression years. Two gentlemen in the center, Dr. W. Edward Deming and Dr. Joseph Juran, they were sent to Japan after World War II to rebuild their economy. And listening to these two great gentlemen, a father of quality movement, Japan came up and built up their industrial economy. And of course, late President John F. Kennedy, the young president who excited the nation. Now, each one of these great leaders have done something unique, and we can learn from their lifetime of work. And what can we do to help the society as we go forward? Now I'm going to get into some of the several models. We begin with Dr. Stephen Covey's Seven Habits paradigm. He has written a masterful book, The Seven Habits of Highly Effective People. Now, according to Dr. Covey, if you master habit 1, 2, 3, that is your personal victory. Be proactive, begin with the end in mind, and put first thing first. Now, once you come to the workplace and we are engaged with the other people, habit 4, 5, and 6 will give you public victory. Think win-win, seek first to understand before being understood, and synergize. After mastering habit 1 through 6, you need to continue to sharpen the saw and continue to work on the issues. Now, this particular book is so instructive that if we follow some of these guidance, we can do well in whatever project we are on, whatever activities we undertake. Now, people started asking to Dr. Covey that you talked about effectiveness, but what about greatness? So he wrote another book, Habit 8, which is the effectiveness to greatness, the 8th habit. And the concept is one need to listen to the inner voice and allow others to listen to their inner voices within the organization, and out of which synergistically you decide what's the best course of action. Next model is on tipping point leadership. So William Bratton, in the public sector, who worked for well over 2.5 decades in Boston and New York area, both mass transit and police departments. So as we all know, in the 1990, New York was the murder capital of the world, early 1990s. And the work he has done has been written up by 2 faculty from INSEAD, which is the Harvard of the Europe, in the Harvard Business Review article. And what it talks about is, in any organization, there'll be major 4 hurdles. First is cognitive hurdle. That is, unless we recognize there's a problem, people are not ready to solve the problem. Second one is a resource hurdle. Limited resources, you need to prioritize and focus on the most critical issue and then rearrange the resources. Motivation hurdle. When somebody does a good thing, you need to put a spotlight on them so that others can learn from it and get motivated. And the last one is political hurdle. Now, as you all know, in all organizations, there'll be several naysayers who would say, yeah, we have tried this before, it doesn't work. So a great leader, William Bratton was, he kept the authority on his side, convinced them to do the right thing for the city of New York. And now New York is one of the safest city in the world. Now here we are talking about Jack Welch, the retired chairman of GE. During his tenure, stock market went up for GE stock values every year. Now in the book, Winning, key points he's making is leaders upgrade their team constantly. They also live and breathe the vision. They exude positive energy and they are highly optimistic. They have trust in people, but they look for transparency and provide credit. And definitely they have courage to make unpopular decisions. And the real role of the leader is to probe and push, ask the right questions so that the people who are working on it provide the appropriate answers with action, and always inspire risk-taking and learn by setting the example. And main thing is celebration, extremely critical. Now, next model we are looking at here is from Jim Collins, a researcher from the Stanford Graduate School of Business. He did a study of over 1,400 good companies, tracked their financial performance over 40 years. And between 1985 to 2001, those company outpaced others by 300%. He came up with a metaphor by putting the right people on the bus and let them drive the bus. So in other words, for any major issue, look for good people, disciplined people first. When you allow them the flexibility, they will do disciplined thinking, come up with a critical issue which needs to be addressed, and they will build the greatness to last. Now, several examples we can look at. Southwest Airlines is one, Walgreens Pharmacy is another one, where they have adopted this model. Now we look at Jim Collins' level 5 leadership. One, highly capable individual. Two, contributing team member. Three, competent manager. Effective leader, still not level 5 leader. And level 5 executive has the humility and the will. By humility, when something goes wrong, the leader will take all the blame. And when something goes right, he or she will share the credit with everyone who was involved. And by will, when the decisions are made, the strategy is set, he or she will persist to achieve the results required for the organization. In his studies written up in Harvard Business Review, only 4% of the top level executive in Fortune 500 companies, he categorized them as level 5. Very interesting read. Now we want to talk a little bit about our favorite son, Abraham Lincoln. A book written on Lincoln on leadership. I'm going to highlight few areas shown in color. One, the leader should get out of the office and circulate among the people. So as we all know, when Civil War broke out, when South was trying to separate from North, army on the North was very weak and very small in number, 16,000 troops only by 1861. So the first goal of the president was to build the militia. And within 4 years, they were at the level of 500,000, 500,000 people ready to fight on the war. Now, it was Lincoln's routine to go and meet each and every new recruit who was coming to join the army, and he will meet and greet them. So leaders should not be sitting in the ivory tower. They need to circulate among people. Lincoln was a great persuader. He will not coerce anybody. And of course, we all know him as an honest Abe. Honesty and integrity were his hallmark. He was leading by being led, sharing credit, taking blame, level 5 leader. And item 11, he kept searching until he found the General Grant. He fired about 8 generals before he found General Grant, who was very capable and willing to fight. Other generals before him wanted the title, but they did not have a stomach to fight. Lincoln, of course, was the master at the art of public speaking. His short 2-minute speech at the Gettysburg Address, which was only 10 sentences and 271 words, is still considered around the world as the best public speaking item. And he was a great storyteller. And the great leaders provide stories in the organization to motivate everyone. Now I want to share the another model from Mark Murphy, who wrote a book called 100%ers. On the y-axis, challenge, x-axis, emotional connection. By the way, Mark does consulting with Google's and Microsoft of the world. Now, central idea of this book is one need to expect 100% from the himself or herself first, and then 100% from the people around you. In 4 quadrants, the goal should be on the top right quadrant to be 100% leader by providing the challenge to the people, but you are emotionally connected. I had a chance to write a very short blog on leadership paradigm back in 2014 on LinkedIn. And I'm talking about economic value creation, 4 quadrants, top right, servant leadership, focuses on sacrifice and service, very few, you can count them on fingertip. That's Nelson Mandela, Martin Luther King Jr., Mother Teresa, Mahatma Gandhi, and very few in number, right? And Swami Vivekananda will fall into that servant leadership. Bottom right, knowledge leadership, that's where all the educators coming. And I know there are a few educators who are on the call today. Their focus is caring and sharing. They take the rough diamond, all the incoming students polish them so well. So by the time they're ready to graduate, they are ready to shine. Top left, C-suite, focus on growth and profit. That's a value leadership. Most of them are not very empathetic with people because they have a short mandate. In 1 or 2 years, they have to show their value, otherwise they are out. And bottom left is the bad news. Front and middle level management, misuse of power and playing politics. And because of that, a lot of good people leave the organization. Now, here is a roadmap for leadership excellence. Now, we all can become good leader provided we are willing to invest some energy and we are interested in becoming a leader and a good leader. So it requires personal commitment, involvement, and accountability. Secondly, we can only become good leader when we receive feedback to understand about our own behaviors from others around us. Once we get that feedback, which is in organization 360 feedback for the management group, where peers, subordinate, superior, customers, supplier provide the feedback, based on that you determine your strengths and weaknesses, and out of which you want to maintain the top two strengths and want to work on bottom two areas or the worst areas for improvement, develop a short and long-term plans. And in order to improve, one need to start building up the skills, integrate them into the lifestyle, educate through education and training. One need to nurture himself or herself through personal change and behavioral changes. Do regular evaluation to measure progress against the metrics set for short-term and long-term action plans and celebrate success. So this is where very important slide. It's up to us to determine whether you want to be a leader. And once we determine we are leaders, we want to be a good leader. Now we are going into the segment on best practices. So here are some of the core competencies given to us by the US Baldrige framework, which was put in place in 1987, 1988. First set of winners started coming. And so far, there are over 114 Baldrige winners in manufacturing, service, small business, education, healthcare, and nonprofit, including government sector. So the role of the leader is to set the vision, which is the dream for the organization, mission, which is the path to achieve the vision, and identify three or four critical values by which people will work together. Their primary obligation is to set the strategy and provide strategic direction. Their goal should be to teach and enforce ethics starting from themselves all the way down. They need to provide, need to do critical review of the organization's work and allocate right resources, build cohesive teams. They should be master at identifying the talent. They must provide recognition. And their goal should be to coach and mentor next level of leaders. Remember the GE example. They lead the change and they are master communicators. And ultimately, any organization goal should be sustainable growth and development over a long period of time. Now, here we are looking at good practices from Google. What do they teach? The six things they teach to be effective bosses. First one is about mindset and values. They adopted this growth mindset work from Dr. Carol Dweck from Stanford University, which says intelligence can be cultivated. And there is a excellent TED talk by Professor Isabel Lee Duckworth on grit, G-R-I-T, which is passion plus perseverance to achieve long-term goal. Second one is emotional intelligence. Everyone, particularly in the management, should have a sense of self-awareness. Manager transition is extremely critical. So they share the transition challenges and frustrations with their peers in a group setting, and out of which they develop strategies to deploy when they move up in the organization. Coaching, important skill, active listening, cognizant of own and employee mindset, asking open-ended questions, meeting individual communication style, etc. Feedback, consistent feedback across teams by balancing positive and negative feedback, providing authentic and appreciative feedback, and also sharing growth opportunities. And the last item on the decision making, they have developed a framework for better decision making where managers in the groups test out their ideas loud and collect feedback from employees. So this is what world-class organization is doing to develop good leaders. Now Zappos, which is an online selling company, number of products, they started in 1999, and they have developed a flat and self-managed organization model called Holacracy. And three critical points are: everyone is responsible for understanding their role, how it fits with the role of others on the team, and how that changes. Second one, everyone is responsible for leading and supporting simultaneously. And third, everyone is responsible for communicating clearly and efficiently. Great lessons from Zappos. Now, a wonderful article from Harvard Business Review, recent one, what sets successful CEOs apart? Deciding with speed and conviction. So if you want to be a good leader, learn to move with the right amount of speed with the information at hand by trusting your people, engaging for action. Focus on stakeholders' priority and results by engaging employees. Third, adapting proactively. In general, there are no playbook for situations which keep coming up in day-to-day life, but they must be ready to adapt based on their knowledge, based on their skills, and trusting all of the people to support the key decisions, and delivering reliably. Establish business management systems for performance and deliver it to the customer. Now, leaders need to have great focus on social responsibility, areas in which they operate, not just make money, but give back to the society. So here I'm sharing with all of you my personal projects on personal social responsibility. The first one is the Blind Foundation for India. We established that in 89. Once we came to know, India has 15 million blind people, one out of three in the world. And 80% of that blindness is preventable or curable. And with the grace of God, so far we have raised $4 million, providing 190,000 free cataracts, 123 mobile vans, 10,000 braille kits to children for education, and around 850,000 school children checked for their eyesight and given interventions. And all in all, 1 million adults got their free eyesight checkups. More information at the website blindfoundation.org. Second initiative is in the education sector. In India, the engineering students who are brilliant, but they neglect or do not put proper emphasis on soft skills, and they are not aware about quality management topics. So back in 2013, we started a gift of knowledge transfer leveraging technology project which is connecting with number of institutes throughout India using Google Hangout, which is free, and recording those sessions on YouTube, which is also free. By doing that, we have reached out to 50 institutes in 14 states of India, benefiting well over 675,000 people in India. And the entire project is written up on the website for American Society for Quality India office. So in summary, leadership is all about influencing, igniting, and inspiring ordinary people to do extraordinary things. So let me repeat, leadership is all about influencing, igniting, and inspiring ordinary people to do extraordinary things. There are lots of great references. There is a Leadership Excellence series I made the reference to, Baldrige Performance Excellence Program, number of books by Stephen Covey, and so on and so forth. Now, if you want to find out your own leadership style, there are two free guidance assignments here. First one is the if you answer these 13 questions, you can find out whether you are an authoritarian, participative, or delegative. And second one is Myers-Briggs Type Indicator Test, 74 question, again, is free. And that personality trait, which is highly useful when you are forming teams, when you are hiring people, when you are making changes in the organization, understanding the MBTI really helps in developing great teams and great people in the on the projects. Now we are going to look at one of the very good YouTube on leadership, that mysterious talent. So I'm going to switch the screen, and the YouTube is aligned. So I will try to set it up.
Thank you.
Okay, and I'm going to give you the screen back, Manu. Manu. Hello, everyone. So we are experiencing some technical difficulties. So if you could just give us a brief moment and we're going to move to the question section. Okay. And you can probably see Manu on the screen. Can you say something on the phone? And I'm going to see if they can hear you from my phone.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm hanging up the phone and talk through the laptop, correct?
No, if you could stay on the phone. If someone can unmute themselves and let me know if you can hear Dr. Vora.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, great.
Okay.
Okay. So we apologize for these technical difficulties. We're having some issues with the web software that we're using, but we're going to go into the question section. So if anyone has questions and you're on the phone, please feel free to ask. Or if you are on the web, you can use the chat section and I'll read those questions to Dr. Vora. Okay, so it does not look like we have questions at this time. There are a few things you guys can do if you have questions later. I am going to put something in the chat box and I'm going to type it here. But if you have questions for Dr. Vora, you can go to or you can email at alumni at iit.edu. And that is in the chat box. You can submit questions there. Or if you have his email address, you can send that directly to him, or you can ask me, and I will direct those questions to him later. This presentation will be on our website following this. I'm going to take over the screen just so they can see the last slide. Give me one moment. Okay. So this is information on an upcoming our next webinar. Give me one moment. Okay. So our next webinar is on October 27th, which is a Friday. It's here on campus in the MTCC auditorium. This is a free discussing LGBTQ rights in the workplace. Everyone is welcome to attend. We will be streaming that video live as well. And if you register, you'll receive that information similar to how you received information for this talk today. And if you look at the screen that I'm sharing with you, the past Hawk Talks presentation link, this is how you can see Dr. Vora's presentation today. Okay. And it will, excuse me, it will be posted later today or early tomorrow. If you want to share this with other people who may be interested or just review it for yourself. Does anyone have any questions? Okay.
So thank you so much, Chanel, and
Okay.
everyone who are on the webinar. Appreciate your time, and I wish all of you a lot of luck.
All right. And thank you again, Dr. Vora. We really enjoyed having you today. And hopefully we can have you back at another time for another presentation.
Okay, my pleasure. Thank you, Chanel.
Thank you.
Bye.